Is your wallet feeling lighter because you're still paying for your adult kid? It's a common belief that financially supporting them well into adulthood is the best way to launch them successfully. What if I told you that approach actually holds them back? Today, we're shaking up the status quo and we're exploring how setting financial boundaries can empower your adult children to stand on their own two feet. If you're wondering, how can we make this a smooth transition? Let's unpack this important topic and give you the tools to make positive changes in your family's financial dynamic, including real life stories that will inspire and guide you. Let's get our fingers warmed up and get into those comments. Parents of adult kids, when did you stop supporting your adult children? And if you haven't yet, what's keeping you from doing so? And for those parents with younger ones, like myself, when do you plan on making this transition? So today, we're hitting a subject that hits pretty close to home for a lot of parents. Get ready for a wild statistic. We're talking about parents who financially support their adult kids. We'll discuss when is the right time to stop, the consequences if you don't cut the financial cord, and how to navigate this tricky terrain while maintaining those precious bonds with your kids.
Now, throughout this episode, I'm going to refer to your adult children as kids because to me, my kids, they're always going to be my kids.
Ready for that statistic? According to a survey done by Credit Karma, nearly one-third of parents with adult children still provide financial support. This support can range from paying for their groceries, other like smaller items, to bigger handouts, like a down payment for a house, a car payment, or paying off loans. But this doesn't come without a cost to the parents. Pun intended. The emotional and financial toll on parents is substantial. Out of the parents surveyed, 69% admitted that they have personal financial stress because of the continued support. Wait. Nearly one out of every three parents with adult kids, they're still paying, like, so they're still giving handouts. And of those parents that are doing this to themselves, 70% are stressed out about their money situation. That's not okay. You shouldn't have to work this hard and worry if there will still be retirement funds left for you or if you'll be able to retire at all. Full transparency, I say this as an adult kid who received handouts from my parents, but I gotta tell you, it made me feel like crap. Every month, I would promise myself to not make emotional decisions, like emotional buying decisions. And every month, the bills would come in and I'd go crawling back with my hand out, my tail between my legs. But I kept myself in this cycle for far too long because besides feeling crappy and maybe less than my peers, I didn't have any external pressure or motivation to change. But my parents weren't alone. It's a widespread belief that helping your children financially well into adulthood is a necessary part of parenting. However, financial expert Susie Orman, she says, don't do it, especially for parents that are nearing retirement. She argues that parents must kind of put on their oxygen mask first, so to speak, and prioritize their financial security to avoid becoming a burden to their children later on. Oh, wait, I love that. We got to remember this nugget for when we're coming up with boundary scripts. I'm cutting you off now, so I'm not a burden to you later. Oh, that's good. So how do you strike a balance between being supportive and enabling dependency?
Before we get into that, I should welcome any newbies to the channel. My name is Jess. I'm obsessed with boundaries. If you want to discover how boundaries can strengthen your relationships, lower your stress, and allow you to live a life that aligns with your values, hit that subscribe button and join our very supportive community.
Okay, let's dive back in and see what the experts say to do when you're trying to support your kid without ushering them into a lifetime of complacent dependency. Experts suggest a multi-step approach. Whew, right? Take a deep breath. That's good. You don't have to like snip and cut the line like cold turkey. So step number one, have an honest conversation. Just talk to your kid about your financial situation. Lay out your retirement plan, why it's necessary to cut back on your financial support. This transparency helps your kid understand where you're coming from and it sets the stage for healthier boundaries. I love this a lot. Blame the hard numbers. As a recovering people pleaser, I just want everyone to love me and I want everyone to be happy. So when there is an opportunity to blame something else like hard numbers or a policy,
even though I might have created the policy,
you better bet your bottom dollar I'm gonna take it. I don't wanna cut you off, but the numbers are making me. I could totally see myself doing this. Step number two, create a gradual transition See, this is not so bad. Gradually reduce the amount of help over time, giving your child a chance to become more financially independent. For example, my parents could have said, okay, next month we're only giving you 80% or we're only going to pay your credit card by 80%, and we're going to decrease our contribution by 20% each month until it's zero. Or they could have said, okay, you only have 3 more months to like get your stuff together. This would have given me time to curb my emotional spending and to learn some very necessary budgeting skills. Last, but probably my favorite step, set clear expectations.
Because you know, I'm a girl that loves to avoid resentment traps.
Define what support, if any, you will continue to provide. For example, let's say my parents set the deadline and they also specified that if I ever had a genuine emergency, that they would be there to help me out for necessary bills only, that they would help me with my car payment, that they would help me with rent, but that they would no longer, even in an emergency, help me with the credit card. And that would be because that was the area they believed, or they knew, and I for sure knew, I had to become more responsible in. Before we get into the damage of enabling, check in. How are you feeling after learning it's like a multi-step approach? Is that a relief for you? Or are you still worried that your kid, they're not gonna take it well? If you're worried, let us know in the comments. Tell us your concerns. By opening up, you might gain some super helpful advice from others who are just a few steps ahead of you. But also, by sharing your hesitations, you give other people permission to share theirs. Now, let's dive back in and see what happens to our kids when they are enabled long past what's considered healthy. And this isn't to shame you, this is to encourage you. Your kid actually experiences several severe consequences. Number one, stunted personal growth. Financial enabling can impede the development of essential life skills, such as budgeting, problem solving, and resilience. Adult children need to face and overcome obstacles to develop independence, self-reliance, and self-esteem. Number two, financial dependence. Continuous bailouts can create a cycle of dependency. That was me. Where your kid doesn't learn to manage their finances effectively, leading to long-term financial irresponsibility. Pause. This right here, just think about it. Let's say your daughter is 24 and you're still paying for her lifestyle, even though she has a good job. Think about the world of struggle and conflict you're setting her up for once she gets married. Like her expectations of being able to buy whatever, whenever she wants, it's not realistic for a young couple starting out. Like how unfair for her, because she's not going to have the skills, and how unfair for your future in-law. Severe consequence number three, strained relationships. Over time, enabling behavior can strain the parent-child relationship. Parents can feel unappreciative while the kid might feel controlled or resentful. This is going to lead to emotional distance. And I can totally see this happening, but also, what if the parents aren't on the same page, like in terms of handouts? For instance, let's say your son, who is struggling to find a path after graduation, still lives at home, doesn't have a real job, but expects you to fork over funds not only for groceries, but his whole entire social life. But let's say your husband, Papa Bear, he doesn't agree with that. He doesn't like this plan and how you guys are forking over money. That's gonna strain your relationship and the relationship between father and son. Not good at all. And number four, social implications. Adult children who rely heavily on parental support may struggle to navigate social relationships independently because they have not learned to handle conflict or responsibilities in their own life. This is huge. We grow an incredible amount when we are forced to make discerning decisions about our finances. Imagine how much growth in the empathy and compassion department occurs when you have to go without. You become a better, more humble human being. But what about those exceptional circumstances? Are there times when it's okay to continue supporting your adult kid? Are you nodding right now? Are you thinking, yep, that's me. I have the unique situation. Well, if it is you, share it in the comments. Let us know. Tell us, is your kid struggling with addiction, mental illness? Are they in an abusive relationship? Pause the video. Tell us why you feel your situation is different and that these tips are great, but they don't really apply to you. Okay, exceptional circumstance number one, health issues. If your kid is dealing with a serious health condition that prevents them from working, ongoing support, it might be necessary. In these cases, ensure that you are also exploring all available social services and disability benefits. Go to Google, type in the county that you live in, and social services. Reach out, and if possible, just set up a meeting with another human being to review any possible resources for your child.
So for example, I live in Scott County. Scott County, social services, enter.
Number two, education. Let's say you're supporting your kid through school or they're going through additional professional training. This is an investment in their future, but you need to set a clear limit. You can't just be a student forever, or you can't just be a student living like you don't have a care in the world. So make sure those expectations are clear. Again, we are avoiding resentment at all costs. And number three, temporary unemployment. During short-term financial crises, such as a job loss, temporary support, that can be a lifeline. However, this too should come with, again, clear timelines and a plan for achieving financial independence. And number four, I actually have a bonus one. This kind of seems obvious, but it's worth mentioning. If your kid is going through any crisis, let's say they're leaving an abusive relationship or they're just going through a major life transition, use your best judgment and again, communicate clear expectations along the way. Real life stories are up next, which I don't know about you, but that is my favorite way to learn. But first, take a deep breath and ask yourself if you have learned at least one thing so far today. If the answer is yes, consider hitting that like button. That tells the algorithm that this information is actually helpful, and it pushes it out to more moms and dads just like you who need to hear this message today.
And if you've learned two things today, that's pretty cool, right? Consider subscribing. It's a free way to support the channel, and I would love to invite you into our supportive MYB community.
Story number one, Cindy and her daughter, Alyssa. Alyssa married a guy named Brandon who was extremely financially irresponsible. Oftentimes, he would spend his entire check on pull tabs. One time, he bought a new motorcycle, even though they had a fresh newborn at home. Cindy, Alyssa's mom, was always on the receiving end of Alyssa's breakdowns. Alyssa would call her mom and cry about the latest financial fiasco that Brandon did, and Cindy would help the only way she knew how, by offering to pay Alyssa's bills. This went on for years until Cindy's financial advisor started raising concerns that Cindy might not be able to retire on time if she didn't start slowing down her spending. After a few months of trying to talk to Alyssa about her money woes, Cindy finally sat her daughter down, showed her the numbers, explained how she would no longer be able to essentially bail Alyssa and her family out from Brandon's lapses in judgment. Cindy also shared the name of a marriage therapist that her financial advisor had given her to help Brandon and Alyssa get on the same money page. After several sessions, Brandon and Alyssa were able to set safeguards in place so that the bills were paid first before Brandon could get his hands on and have access to spend the money on any unnecessary items. Cindy got back on track for her financial goals with retirement, and her relationship with her son-in-law Brandon improved. Story number two, Laura and her son James. Laura had been supporting her son James financially since he graduated from college. James had a really good job, but struggled with managing his finances. Often he would come to Laura to get help with rent and other necessary bills. It seemed like every time Laura was ready to snip and cut that financial cord, James would have such good reasons for needing support. Like one time, he spent his rent money when he chose to attend a concert in order to distract himself from a recent breakup. Another occasion popped up when he joined his buddies to go on a trip to see the Eagles playoff game. Laura understood. I mean, the Eagles were James's favorite team since he was 8 years old. But finally, after feeling like she wasn't doing her part as a parent, Laura had an honest conversation with James about her financial needs and retirement plans. They agreed on a gradual reduction in support, starting with James paying a portion of his rent and eventually covering all of his expenses within a year. The result? James learned how to budget better and became more responsible with his money. His perception of money also changed, and he was way more appreciative of everything that Laura had done for him all those years. James realized the value of a dollar, and Laura felt way more secure about her financial future. Story number three, Mark and his daughter, Emily. Mark's daughter Emily faced a sudden job loss and moved back home. Initially, Mark covered all the expenses, but as the months passed, he realized, ooh, this isn't sustainable. Mark had a heart-to-heart with Emily, explaining his financial situation and the importance of her finding a job. They set clear expectations. Mark would support her for 3 more months, during which Emily was expected to actively hunt for a job. This deadline gave Emily the motivation she needed to find a new job and move out. She felt empowered and was really grateful for her dad's support through this tough time. Before we get to the last story, imagine if Mark wouldn't have said anything and Emily kind of milked the situation. Resentment would have totally totally crept into this relationship and hurt it and just like broke it down. Okay, last story. Bob and Mary had worked hard their entire life and they were nearing that final corner to retirement. But then their daughter Lindsay and her husband Ryan fell in love with their dream home and asked if Bob and Mary would be willing to help them out. Now their daughter Lindsay had a very easy life to the point that everybody, including Bob and Mary, would say she's pretty entitled and it doesn't appear that she considers her parents' feelings when she asks for things. Now Mary, she saw this coming. So she had already taken Bob to their financial advisor who highly discouraged them from any significant handouts like a down payment. Next, Bob and Mary sat down their daughter Lindsay, son-in-law Ryan, and they explained their situation and the advice their financial advisor gave them. They also told them about the story of their home ownership and how much self-pride comes from scraping together and really saving that down payment on your own. Bob told Lindsay for that reason, along with the reasons like their retirement goals, they wouldn't be able to help them out. Lindsay and Ryan ended up losing what they thought was the home of their dreams, only to discover that once they did have enough for the down payment, a much better property with even more yard space for their growing family came on the market. The moral of the story is that navigating the end of financial support for your adult kids can be challenging, but it's essential for both you and your children's long-term well-being. By setting boundaries and communicating openly, you can help your kids develop the independence they need while making sure your financial future is solid. Remember, you're not cutting them off completely or even going cold turkey. You're empowering them to stand on their own 2 feet and giving them that little push to do so. If you're still confused about how boundaries work, or maybe you're not even convinced yet that you need boundaries in your life, check out this next video for helpful tips and to see if I change your mind. Thank you so much for spending your time with me today. I appreciate you more than you know. Until the next one, friend, make sure you keep minding your boundaries. Bye.